Right now, the atmosphere is preparing for battle as another upper-end heat wave is forming in the south and a large mass of cooler-than-average air is dropping in from the north. When these air masses collide, several storm systems are going to form and lead to widespread severe weather, just like the last few weeks. These storms will arise from the instability in place in the form of damaging windstorms that will travel huge swaths of the country in short periods of time. And it looks like that'll be true for quite a lot of time ahead of us from when this video is posted. This day 6 to 10 outlook shows more of the same hot versus warm setup, and thus there will probably be highlighted areas of severe weather and extremely heavy rainfall in the battles zone in between them coming up after this week. But first, let's take a look at what's happening now. Meteorologist Andy Hill here at the Weather Desk. Let's dive into what we're up against. So before we get into the juicy details about how all of this schnasty weather is going to go down, let's just get into the brass tacks and talk about who, the what, the where, so we know where the risks are currently. So for severe weather on a scale of marginal or 1 out of 5 low end to high end, 5 out of 5, we actually have an enhanced or 3 out of 5 risk in place today, especially in areas in the orange here. And this enhanced risk will include all hazards possible that you typically see with severe weather. So that's tornadoes, that's hail, very large hail, and also damaging winds. In particular, we're looking at damaging hail and tornadoes being the case throughout the high plains today in these areas of western South Dakota all the way down through southeastern Colorado and northeastern New Mexico. So that'll be our initial risk. And then these storms are expected to go down the line and become more of a damaging wind threat into the latter half of our enhanced risk, or 3 out of 5 here. So that's the Dodge City area and entering the vicinity of Oklahoma into the night hours. So after those storms go through today, we're looking at a bunch of slight risks over the next couple of days, primarily for damaging windstorms that might pop up, as you can see here. These risk areas over the next couple of days are subject to change and are also subject to incredibly low predictability in the summer season. Models are genuinely awful at times at predicting the progression of these damaging windstorms. And those are the same storms that many have seen in the southeast, in the plains, and also even in the northeast in the last month. On July 4th up here in the Twin Cities, my weather app told me that there was not a single chance of rain in the morning, and that severe weather would be possible in the evening. Well, guess what? We got rain in the morning, and we didn't get severe weather in the evening. But I knew better than that. Before I went to sleep on the 4th, I saw a line of storms moving through South Dakota that I knew would continue through unstable air into Minnesota. And sure enough, when I woke up in the morning to some thunderclaps, I knew those storms overhead me then would suck up the remaining instability for the rest of the day and diminish any chance for severe weather, possibly making for a great night for fireworks, which indeed did happen. Sorry for any pets in the local area. So given that scenario, me analyzing what's happening as a meteorologist, let's see how realistic today's models are in their output. We can do that by looking at the ingredients in place rather than the simulated storms or the future radar, as you guys like to say. Once we look at those ingredients, we can say how confident we are in that future radar. A cold front is continuing very slowly across the eastern time zone over the next few days, bringing some strong and possibly severe storms up through southern Ontario and over into Quebec today. But in the plains, that cold front has come to a dead stop. There's some high pressure, clear skies behind it for a brief period of time, and more comfortable temperatures up here. But I don't see a low pressure anywhere in our expected severe weather threat today. How is it that we have a 3 out of 5 risk today without a central storm system to look at? The key is actually in the winds and the topography. Around this high pressure, air is flowing clockwise. And as you go west towards Denver, the elevation increases dramatically despite the flat plains. That means there's a component of surface winds that are actually rising as they go up the slope. This provides a source of lift for storms to form, and this is called an upslope flow regime. And in this regime, we have instability. We're looking at the Cape here, or available potential energy for storms, and that highlights that there is moisture and also cold air above the surface right in this vicinity in our active severe weather area today. All we need now is to look at the winds above our heads, which is what this chart is showing. How the winds change as we go up above the surface tells me what kind of storms we'll see. Messy clusters, or organized lines of storms or intense supercells. It also tells me whether those supercells, if they were to form, are going to pose primarily a large damaging hail threat or also have the chance to be efficient tornado producers. So in the evening hours, models are agreeing that a local jet or a region of increased wind speed will form a couple of miles up in this vicinity. So knowing that, let's look at the slice of the atmosphere in eastern Colorado. This photograph on the right here, a measure of winds changing with speed and height as you go up, indicates a mixed storm mode is possible. Not very much change in the winds is occurring in the first kilometer above the surface, but there is just a little bit. This feature in particular points to efficient hail production. The rest of this photograph tells me that the winds are changing direction with height and also generally increasing in speed. This will definitely serve to give us supercells. And we've seen this many times in the high plains, especially the last month, where these storms are generating quite a bit of hail, and then sometimes they'll have a tornado warning on them. So this happens because these storms have the chance to modify their local environment, and that can cause some pretty funky things to happen. As a result, given this photograph over here, I definitely think we have the chance to see both large hail and also weak tornadoes simultaneously tomorrow, especially in eastern Colorado. And this will be mostly in rural areas outside of the I-25 corridor and metro areas. Now let's see what the model shows. Looks like several supercells start to form and persist through the evening to early nighttime hours traveling south and east, before generally becoming a cluster of storms here near Oklahoma City on Friday morning. That's some pretty high confidence right there. We'll see if a live stream on this channel is needed for this risk today. If so, looks like that will probably start in the evening hours, which means I'm going to need to get some sleep between now and then. And that bit carries us into the weekend forecast. On Friday into the weekend here, we devolve into a persistently tough to predict regime for active weather, where we wave hands and say that a long belt of active weather is going to happen, essentially from the central plains all the way up into the northeast, as well as southeastern Canada. And a lot of this active weather that's highlighted here in the yellow and reds here for Saturday is happening along this stalled front. And what that tells me is that generally our biggest concern is going to be excessive rainfall or flash flooding risks. The stall front will create a lot of storms wherever it lies, and thus we see a long period of flash flooding outlooks over the next 5 days for these areas. Starting with tomorrow's outlook here, training thunderstorms are going to become much more frequent. Training meaning like train cars. They follow each other and track over the same areas. And that's just the short term here over the next 5 days. This pattern will continue for quite some time as we look out ahead after these 5 days. Our storm battle zone here is not going to be just one and done kind of thing. From days 6 to 10, we have above average precipitation expected up here, also extending up into Alberta as well. And more rounds of storms are going to be possible, just like what we saw with attendant flash flooding risk through these areas of the Midwest and the Central Plains, and also once again into the Northeast and southeastern Canada. So it's going to take some time for this collision in our storm battlegrounds to complete. Why is it happening? A lot of y'all like to know where things are coming from and why, and that's good. I'm looking for bright minds like yours. Well, essentially what you're looking at here is a large blocking high pressure pattern that is setting up over the Four Corners region, and that will set up this continued storm battle zone for a long period of time. You can see that says July 17th, July 18th. It looks like the wave is just sitting there menacingly. And we can see this very well in our ensemble model runs. Basically, what an ensemble model does is it takes a base model run like we usually look at and has a bunch of different tweaks to small things like initialization, slightly different physics, or parameterization of variables. You can imagine it as one run changing the temperature of your house by 1 degree, or another one giving you a 5 mph greater wind gust. So just imagine all those different possibilities, and the ensemble model takes those together and averages them to come up with what is actually a very skillful forecast. By averaging all of them into one, we can see large-scale patterns especially well, like this one that's setting up over the Four Corners. And that's exactly what the Climate Prediction Center is using to give you this. A high risk for excessive, dangerous heat here, especially over New Mexico, in the El Paso, Texas area. This doesn't look too monsoony to me. And this is expected to start to take place around July 13th to the next week after that. So there it is, swirling away down there. And not only will this bring heat to the southwest, it will set up that storm battle zone continually where the belt of higher winds are to the north of this high pressure area right in this vicinity. In this region, cooler than average air from the north will be in close proximity to the hot and humid air within the stubborn ridge that's kind of just been sitting here. And the air aloft is going to be faster as depicted in this chart, giving more wind shear. So it is likely that storms will form within this region for a long period of time. We've got wind shear, we've got hot and humid thunder boomer fuel, and we've got lift from both those stationary fronts that are draped along this region and will continue to be so, as well as possible upslope flow happening on the surface like we talked about. So that'll explain why we see multiple rounds of storms right in the battle zone. And these storms will very likely be MCSs, or mesoscale convective systems, which are very common in the summertime. We've seen them all over the place, moving west to east through parts of Oklahoma, moving north to south through parts of Alabama, through Nashville, Tennessee in the past month. You guys remember those windstorms. Those are from MCSs. I talk about them all the time during the live streams I do on this channel. So to recap, these MCSs, or mesoscale convective systems, are big lines of thunderstorms that move considerable distances and look something like this. So this is the typical thunderstorm that'll move through, be very heavy for 5 to 10 minutes, and then it's just going to rain for quite some time afterward. Light to moderate rain, but also some lightning is possible with some of these. But also sometimes the lightning happens back in here as well. So this is the MCS here, expected to go through parts of Oklahoma, maybe Oklahoma City, maybe Tulsa, in the early morning hours of Friday. The results of our severe risk in place later today when this video is posted. So these bad boys generally start out from one or several small thunderstorms. Since this supercell up here in eastern Colorado is going to rain on the air below it, it's going to cool that air down. And since cooler air is more dense than the hot, humid air surrounding the storms, cool air is going to flow out ahead of the storm in what's called an outflow boundary. Typically, we see these on radar that show up like this out ahead of the storm. I'll point them out often. That cold air is going to wedge under the hot, humid air out in front of this, and that's going to create new storms all along a line here. And all those storms are going to start raining on themselves as well, and that's going to broaden out our cold pool of air, creating another outflow boundary until there's one big long line of storms chugging along. So this damaging windstorm is going to continue into Friday morning until it either spreads out too much, like that Midwest derecho we covered recently, or we see the outflow boundary from the storms way out ahead of them, which prevents any of that moist air from really reaching in there, and thus they begin to die off. Or the air out ahead of the complex is generally cooler and stable, which we're not really going to see in the summer. In this case, it's definitely hot and unstable. So for this model run and this situation into Friday morning, we're going to need to see these storms fan out and also outpace themselves here. And that's exactly what this model thinks will happen as they dissipate Arkansas. So given relatively difficult to predict exact impact weather coming up, let's talk about Canada, because they've had a lot of smoke recently, and that smoke keeps finding its way down into the US. And Canada's also had a violent tornado this week. A strong cold front for this time of year has made its way down from Canada into the US, bringing a cool down to these areas, as we've talked about. But this hasn't brought any wildfire relief, as we are still seeing over 600 of them burning across Canada, with over half of them being out of control. Since they're still blazing, which is natural for the pine forests in the area and is essential to their reproduction cycle, the right combination of another cold front and upper level winds could bring another dose of smoke to some of us in the US, and also to more people in the Canadian provinces. Now, despite some hazy conditions from local wildfires in the Pacific Northwest, it doesn't look like we'll be dealing with a larger scale smoke induction into the US. But this low pressure could bring something as we exit the weekend and enter the week. So with any cold front that passes through, we're going to have to monitor and see if smoke is going to come along with it. Smoke is pretty difficult to predict in the near term though, so this is not something I can tell you confidently yet, besides that the source hasn't gone out, so it's very possible that we could continue to see another round of smoke. So a bit about that violent tornado. It was the first EF4 equivalent tornado in Alberta since the Edmonton tornado in 1987. And this one this week hit between Carstairs and Didsbury. Thankfully, no casualties. Now, of course, there have probably been a few tornadoes of that strength in between these times, but their impacts remain less than violent. And that's how the scale works. As a result, a very localized area is vulnerable, and I'm going to take a look ahead to see if there's any similar risk coming up for Alberta. So looking at this map of winds aloft once again, I don't see much support, especially in the near term, for anything organized, except clusters of hailstorms as is typical for this time of year in the province. That has the potential to change around the weekend after this one, once we get to the 14th into the 15th. Though that time span might be likely to change given model inaccuracies this far away. You can see this jet move in around that time, and that would provide enough wind shear for a supercellular mode given moisture and instability in this region, which will be likely in place. So all in all, things look to be active. That's been the key word here as we continue on into our stormy summer season. So just make sure you're using my channel as one resource to keep up and learn about the weather as it happens. And pay attention to your local National Weather Service forecast office, who I really want to build off of so that we can complete the circle for you. Also, the Y'all Squad channel has a new video you should check out. It showcases our relief efforts in Perryton, Texas. Thanks for watching, and I hope to forecast for you again.